Okay, let's start with a little recap about graphing these inequalities. A graph of these inequalities, just like any other graph of any other thing, equation or inequality, is a, well, it's a graph, right? What's a graph made of?
Infinite points.
Infinite number of points. Okay, and with these inequalities, it seems like maybe there's like more infinitely many points than with just, say, a line. Does that make sense? Because what we wind up with is a line, okay? And not just a line, but half, what is that, half. This class came up with, I think Caden said blacked out.
Yeah,
blacked out. Right, blacked out. I think it's a really good description because what is it blacked out by?
All the dots.
All those dots that work. Right. Okay, so the line is what we get when what happens in this inequality?
It's got an equal to in it, like it can be the line.
Well, even if this equal to part wasn't here, we still get a line from all of the combinations of x and y that make both sides equal. Even if the equals to is not there. Right? And then we use a dotted line, right? We still want the line, we're still interested in where the line is, but we may not always want to include the line in our graph. Right? We may want to put a dot in there. So the line is what happens when we get both sides equal to each other. Whether or not we want them to be equal, that's still where the line comes from, when both points are equal. Or, sorry, both sides are equal, like this, right? And now it just looks like the old days when I would ask you to draw a graph of a line. That's the line part when they're equal. Maybe I'll make a little note of that here, y equals 3x minus 1, right? When they're both equal to each other. And the blacked out half comes from when what happens?
When it's greater than or less than.
Right, when they're not equal. And of course, we want them to be not equal in the way that we want them to not be equal. So this comes from when they're not equal. In this case, in this problem, in this inequality, it happens when this side, right, the y side is less than the side with x on it. So always a line, and then half is blacked out. So we need to find that line. And since I've kind of made a note of both of these, we can scroll down a bit and still see what we're working with. The line, the equal part, we can graph that, okay? Because we know that this is the what?
Y-intercept,
and this is the what?
The slope.
So we have a y-intercept of negative 1. We have a slope of 3 over 1, right? So we go over 1, and up 1, 2, 3. Over 1 and up 3. So there's another point. Do we want both sides to be equal? Is that okay with us? Do you remember? As I scroll down, you can't see it anymore?
Mm-hmm.
Can't remember?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
there's
an equal two there. So why did I ask that question before I graphed the line?
Solid
or dotted, right? Which one is it?
Solid.
This line is made of infinitely many points, okay? Such as this one, 1, 2, okay? So it's made of infinitely many points, and if I plug in x is 1 and y is 2 into this inequality, what's going to happen? What's that?
Equal.
Both sides will be equal. Both sides will be exactly the same. So 2 is less than or equal to 3 times 1 is 3. 3 minus 1 is 2. Exactly equal. Any point on that line will do exactly that. Maybe not 2 equals 2, but it'll give you something. 3 equals 3, 5 equals 5, 0 equals 0, whatever. Both sides will be equal. Okay? And we like those points. We like both sides to be equal according to what's written there. Now we need to figure out which half gets blacked out. So I'm going to show you the easy way. I said that's what I would show you last time. And then this time, I'll show you the smart pants way? I don't know. It's just a little more, it's something else. It's just something else. So we want to figure out which half is blacked out. One of the halves is going to be blacked out by points that make the y side less than the other side with the x in it. So how did we figure out which half is the blacked out half? Remember that? Sure. We're gonna get into that, like if it's greater than, is it up there, is it to the right, is it to the left? First of all, don't pick right and left, okay? I don't typically just tell math students what to do. Okay, I want you to think for yourselves, but I'm just gonna give you a helpful tip. Don't think of it as on the left of the line and on the right of the line, think of it as above the line and below the line. You'll see why in just a second. But that's not what we really concern ourselves with. We didn't worry about that, like, oh, it's greater than, so it's below the line, or it's above the line, because it's whatever. Do you remember how we found the half that's blacked out?
Yeah. Get a point.
Get a point.
From inside, above the line.
From up here, from down here, right? Test it out. What was that point that I liked so much that I used?
Zero, 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 zero.
As long as that 0, 0 is not on the line, right? If I tested it and it was on the line, it would be kind of a pointless test because it would be on the line and I'd just get both sides equal to each other. It wouldn't tell me anything about the blacked out half. So 0, 0, not on the line. So I'll try it out. 0, 0, right? And this needs to happen. This side needs to be less than this side. Let's see if it is or if it isn't. 0 less than 3 times 0 minus 1. Is this true or false? It's false. 0 is not less than negative 1. It's greater than negative 1. So I picked this point right here, which is above the line, and it didn't work.
So it's the other side.
Seems to be the other side that's blacked out by all those points. Make the inequality not equal. So again, the points on the line make both sides of the inequality the same as each other, equal. And from the blacked out half, which where I don't have enough time to black that out completely, unless I have like a nice big marker or something. That's really what it means, right? It is fully blacked out by all those points, the points that make it not equal. So equal on the line, not equal, this blacked out half. All right, so there you go. There's method number one, test point. Right? Test the point, method one. Test point. Okay, method two has to do with, well, it's greater than, so it's above, or it's less than, so it's below, or something like that. Okay. Let's think about y. Okay. When you look at y on a graph, what can you tell me about y on the plane here? You got x's and you got y's. What's the difference between x's and y's on the plane here? Just one main difference, like we do, Sean.
X's go horizontally, y's go up vertically.
All right. So y is a vertical thing. Okay, y is a vertical thing. So y, a vertical thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
On the graph, it's vertical. The vertical thing needs to be less than something. Okay? You can almost think of this part as like the line, right? Plug in x's, you get out y's, and you get this line from all those points. But y needs to be less than, and y is vertical. When you think about vertical, where do you see things that are less, things that are smaller? When you think about them vertical, are they verticals up and down? Are they up here? Are they down here?
They're
vertically,
down.
Where do the smaller things come from?
Down.
From down, right?
Yeah.
The negatives go down. So notice when y is supposed to be less than the stuff on the line, then y being vertical and needing to be less is down, below the line. Right? If you think of it to the right and to the left, it's going to mess you up. All right, because when you the difference between a positive and a negative slope is gonna mess you up when you think of it by and left. But you think below and above, right? Since y is vertical, well, you should think of it as a below and above. All right. Now, if it was x is less than or greater than or whatever, then you would think left and right because x is horizontal. But we never do that, right?
Right.
Maybe until calculus, essentially think of x in terms of y. No, it's inverse functions. That's for another day. So y, being a vertical thing and needing to be less, The things that are less in the vertical dimension are below everything else, okay? The things on the line make both sides equal in the inequality, and the points below have a y that is less. The ones that are above have a y that's bigger than the y on the line, right? And the y's that are below have a y that's less than the y that's on the line. For any point here, like this one, I'll rewrite this point, 1, 2, this x, right, is going to give us a y of 2, right? It makes both sides equal. With an x of 1 and a y of 2, both sides are equal. If I pick a point that's below that, then I get a y that is less, right? If I pick like 1, 1, which is down here, then the y side will be less. And it will be true for any other point down here below this point. If I pick a point up here, well, that's going to give me 1, 3, and the y is going to be bigger. And that works for every point on the line. This one, right? This y is going to be less. This y is going to be less. This y is going to be less. This point, this y is going to be less. And this y is going to be less. And so on. Okay? So method two, if y is less, as long as you have it in slope-intercept form, if y is less than, let's say, mx plus b, okay? Well, now y needs to be less than, so where would you shade it, above or below? Because y needs to be less, and y is vertical, and vertically less than things are down, right? So below the line. And if y is greater than mx plus b, right, think about this, this tells you exactly where your line is going to be, and y needs to be bigger than that, and y is vertical, and vertically things that are bigger are up above. So we shade above. Now, I could have jumped to this explanation, or this little, I don't know, straightforward, matter of fact, if it looks like this shade below, if it looks like this shade above, but I didn't do that, because you know that's not my style. My style is explain why all of that is true, okay? So if you forget everything I just said and just remember this, if you're a really good rememberer, then you'll get it right. And if your memory sometimes fails you, you may get it wrong. So don't just concentrate on this, the conclusion. Think about all the other stuff that I just said, why I said it, what it means, okay? And then know why this is true. So here we go. Two different methods. I could just take a test point, plug it into the inequality. If it's true, shade the side that point came from. If it's not true, shade the other side, like we just did. Or say to yourself, well, y needs to be less, y is vertical. Vertically, things that are less than are down, so I'll shade below, and vice versa for bigger than. Well, that makes sense, because there's a lot of words. Does that work for you? Can I explain number 35? Kids?
I'm kind of a little confused.
Okay.
So if it's a less than sign, it's below.
As long as y is by itself.
Y is by itself.
Y is by itself. If it's not, it kind of messes everything up. Right? The whole thing hinges on y being by itself because y is vertical, right? Y is up and down. That's
so
why this works.
Okay, so as long as y is by itself. But if y isn't by itself, it's the other way around?
If y isn't by itself, then all this isn't going to work. There's no like it's the other way, it's this way, it's that way. Y needs to be by itself. So if y isn't by itself and you want to use this, then get y by itself, right? Just cancel everything else out that isn't y. Quote, move it to the other side, right?
Okay.
And then you'll have it set up this way. You could always take a test point. You can always just take a test point, put it in there. If it works, shade it. If it doesn't, shade the other side. Does that help?
Okay.
Sean?
So,
oh, sorry, I'll come back to you.
On some of them, the x and y were on the same side.
Yeah.
Would we find the mx plus b and then do one of those two?
I think that's a pretty easy way to go.
Okay.
I mean, you can graph it that way. That's called like standard form, and you can plug it in. 0 for x and 0 for y. Find the y-intercept and the x-intercept, and you can plot it. Then, you know, we've done that before.
Yeah.
And that's a way that you can do it, and then use a test point. Or you can get it in slope-intercept form.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, I just gonna say because I was looking at 29 through 31 and it was the opposite way.
29 through 31. Right, because all of these have x and y at the same time, so why would that be?
That's why my question came up.
Yeah.
That does it matter? What difference is it opposite?
Right. If you really want to know the quickest way that I could tell you, you see how, like, yeah, for each of these, like, 29, y is on the less than side.
Mm-hmm.
You see how there's a negative in front of it?
Yeah.
If you were to get y by itself, and at the very end you divide it by negative 2 to get y by itself, what would you do with that inequality sign?
Change it.
Flip it around, right? So now y would be on the greater than side, and then it would match exactly what you see in the graph that matches that.
So negative.
So if there's a negative, then yeah, it flips, kind of flips it around. If there's a negative in front of the y, then it flips it around.
Okay.
So, yeah. I think it's kind of complicated, and I wouldn't write those as like little rules. Okay, but except if y has a negative in front of it, then it, you know, I would say you get y by itself. That's the easiest way to go. What was that? 35, then
38,
and 44. Okay, so here's an example where y is not by itself. I'm just going to go ahead and get y by itself. That's a handy thing to do. Okay, so when you get y by itself, I'm going to subtract 5x from both sides. You get negative 2y is less than or equal to, I'm going to put negative 5x plus 6 because it looks like mx plus b that way. Divide by negative 2 on both sides. So now y is a positive 1 times y. And we've divided by negative, so we need to flip this guy around, greater than or equal to. When you divide by negative 2, we have multiple terms separated by addition or subtraction. We need to divide each of those terms by negative 2. So negative 5 divided by negative 2 is positive 5 halves times x. And 6 divided by negative 2 is negative 3. Now we have it looking like y equals mx plus b. And we can graph it pretty easily. Right? We're going to graph that line. Negative 3 is our y-intercept. The slope is 5 halves, so I'm going to move over 2 and up 5. Right there. Over 2 and up 5. And the line, what kind of line is it going to be?
Solid line.
A solid line. We got the equals 2, right? If we want to include those points that make both sides equal. So we have the line, it is solid, because we do like for both sides to be equal, since there's that equals 2 part. And we just need to figure out which half should be shaded in. Let's use method number 2 that we just learned, right? Y needs to be greater than, right? Y goes up and down.
So the top?
On the top, right? The bigger things vertically, bigger things are on top, right? That's where big stuff is. That's where a million is. It's way up there. A billion is way up there, up there. So we'll shade above. I don't have time to shade it all in, but you get the idea, and I'll get the idea when you shade it in. Right? It doesn't have to be you're sitting there with your pencil sideways and shading, it doesn't matter. Get the idea if you shade in a little bit there. Okay. So this half is all blacked out. I'm just kind of quizzing you again. This half is blacked out by what?
Points.
By points, okay, those points. What's special about those points in this inequality?
They all work.
Which way?
Above.
What did they do? How did they work in this inequality? What about them makes the inequality work? What's going to happen when I take a point from inside this blacked out area as opposed to on the line?
It'll be the y will be greater than the x.
Right. Yeah. This side is greater than this side. Every single one of these infinitely many points, this side will be greater than this side. And every one of these infinitely many points on this line will make it. What's that?
Equal.
Equal. It'll be exactly equal on both sides. And over here, Nothing works, because this side would be less. Okay, number 44. 44. Word problem. In order for the drama club to cover the expenses of producing the play, at least $1,500 worth of tickets must be sold. So, $1,500 in tickets sold. To make little notes when I'm solving the problem. Okay, well, that's all the information they give us there. Part A, it says, use a model to write an inequality that represents this situation. There's a little sign here. It says, adults have to pay $10 and students have to pay $6. Okay. So they're going to sell some tickets to adults, some tickets to students, right? And it's going to create some revenue, right? And they take the amount that they make off the adults and the amount that they make off the students, and what are they going to do with those numbers?
Together.
And those numbers added together need to come out to be what?
Equal to or greater than
1,500. Yes, okay, very good. So, the amount they make off the tickets, which we haven't completely clarified, they do need to be greater than or equal to 1,500. Okay. And maybe we'll make this one X and this one is Y. We add them up and we get greater than or equal to 1,500. So we sell X number of adult tickets. How do we calculate how much we made off of adults, John?
10
times
10X.
10 times X. Students?
6 times Y.
6 times Y. Okay. I could graph this as what we call the standard form, put in a 0 for X and find that Y, and put in a 0 for Y and find the X. We find the Y intercept, the X intercept, and graph it. But I'm just going to go ahead. Make it look like y equals mx plus b, right? Standard, or y-intercept form. 6y is greater than or equal to negative 10x plus 1,500, just subtracted subtracted 10x from both sides, divide by 6, right? You do not need to flip that inequality sign around, we divide it by a positive 6. Negative 10 divided by 6 is going to be negative 5/3 x, right? Divide by 2 on both of those, dividing this by 6, we get negative 5/3. Dividing 1,500 by 6, I don't know. It should work, yeah, so that would be 250. So plus 250. So there's our slope intercept form. So we can just kind of call it 250. And maybe we'll make it. That's 250. That's 150. And that's 50. And that's 50. So there's our y-intercept, and we're 3 and down 5. Let's maybe go over 30 and down 50. We'll make this also 50, 100, 50. Okay. So we'll go over 30 and down 50, so that it's be difficult to figure out how much over 3 and down 5 is, right? So tiny. So move over 30, which is easier to estimate. That's about right there. Over 30 and down 50 would be right there. That's closer. Something like that. Okay. And where should I shade?
Above.
It's we got a greater than here, right? And I didn't think about it before I drew it, but is it a solid line? At least, yeah. They say at least, so 1,500 will cover their expenses or more. So, yeah, and above, right? So this would be where they sell just enough tickets right on the line. They just barely squeaked by and sold enough tickets to adults and students to make it, right? But if they're above, right, any combination that's above that, well, they made past $1,500. So use a model to write an inequality that represents the situation. Oh, gosh, we did a lot more than that. We wrote the inequality, there it is. We rewrote the inequality. Part B says graph the inequality, which we just did it anyway. Okay, 80 adults and 110 students attend the play. Does the drama club cover its expenses? So 80 adults, that's X would be 80, right? And Y would be 110. How can we figure out if this covers their expenses? So what do you do? Video, say Sean, say Josie. Ready?
Can you just plug in those numbers for x and y?
Absolutely, yeah. We can use our model, this one, or this one, or this one. They're all the same. They're all going to be the same truth, okay? So this one's nice. So I'm going to go ahead and do that one. So it was 10, grab another color, 10 times x, the number of adults. The number of adults was 80. Something like a lot. Plus 6 times 110. That needs to be greater than or equal to 1,500. And if it is, then they did it. If it's not, then they didn't. 10 times 80 is 800. Plus 6 times 110, 660. So that is 1460. Oh, they just missed it. 1460 is not greater than 1500. It's false. So 8110, you know, it's going to be somewhere, if I were to kind of cheat, right, and put it like right there, it's just below the line. Shoot, it just missed it. Right, if I had a super, super good graph and the ability to read that graph very, very accurately, I could look for that point and see, is it in the shaded area or is it not? And that would also tell me whether or not they made their goal of 1,500 more. Does that all make sense? Any questions? Okay. Let me go ahead and give you this. Everybody's doing. Actually, I'm not sure that to you until we get all ready. Alright, this shouldn't be too hard. This if you use the test point method, then this is part of every graphing problem we do anyway. Okay. We can test and see if this is a solution to inequality. How do we check and see if an order pair is a solution to inequality? Besides the usual. Alex?
You put 3 in for x, mm-hmm. and negative 5 for y.
Got it. So negative 5 for y, negative 2/3 times x is 3. It's 3, and we see, does it come out true or does it come out false? Negative 5, let's see, 3 divides 3, leaves 1. Negative 2 times 1 is negative 2 minus 3. So, true or false?
False. It is false.
False. It is false. Right? Why is it false? What's it? Missing 3.
The equal, it's not equal to, so.
Doesn't have that little condition, so no. Yes?
Could you have, I graphed the equation, and then I found if it was true. So it landed exactly on the line, but it wasn't equal to, so I found it wasn't true.
How were you sure that the point that you found was exactly 3, negative 5, that was exactly on the line?
I plotted the y-intercept and then used.
You just follow the slope down, down, down.
Yeah.
Okay. That sounds good. So it landed on the dotted line.
Yeah, which isn't true.
Which makes it not true. Because this is exactly why it is.
It's exactly.
So no, not a solution. Emphatic. Y-intercept of 1, slope of 5/8. So we're gonna go over 8 and up 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Put a line, what kind of line?
Solid.
Yeah, not dotted, solid. Then we're going to shade it. Where are we going to shade it?
Above,
right? Y needs to be greater. Y is vertical. Vertically, the things that are greater are above, and so we shade above.